Pentecost. So welcome to the house of God at Providence Methodist Church, just in case you didn't know where you were. I am Michael Boyne. It's my pleasure to be with you this morning. And just as a way of a little housekeeping, we do not have any multimedia services this morning. We don't have any member of the team, and so because of that, there'll be no projection of the service, of the hymns. So please make sure that you have your order of service where most things are printed, as also maybe your VIP, but the hymns are also printed here. So with that in mind, I bid you to rise for the call to worship. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised in the city of our God. We meditate upon your steadfast love, O God, in the heart of your sanctuary. Your praise. Fill us with your spirit as we worship in truth. And as we worship in truth, we can only do that with God's Holy Spirit. So we're going to sing, "There's a Sweet, Sweet Spirit in This Place." Also VIP 160.
Thank you.
as we continue with a prayer of worship and adoration. Let us pray. Father, in your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And so this day we worship you, for you are our creator. You who designed the universe, our galaxy, our solar system. Just this week we saw glorious pictures of your universe. We saw your majesty, your glory, your infinite power and might. You are Lord over nature, and we know that in you we live and move and have our being. You loved us first before we even loved you. And out of that love, you sacrificed yourself freely to bring us to you despite our sinful nature. And we see your love nailed to the cross. We thank you that you let the rain fall on the righteous and the unrighteous. That your grace and your love ensures that we are fed, we are clothed, we are cared for, just like the lilies of the field, the birds of the air. Truly, there is none like unto you. So today, Father, we stand in your presence. And we ask that your Holy Spirit fill our hearts and our spirits. Even now, we listen for your still, small voice, guiding, comforting us, calling us, empowering us this morning. Lead us in our worship, in our prayers, our songs, and as we meditate on your word, so that we leave this place revived. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. And while seated, let us sing the worship song, "Here I Am to Worship," also included in your order of service. brothers as we are, sisters as we are here worshiping and bowing down and knowing that He is our God. But we see our sin upon that cross. And we know that we're not worthy of that love. So we're going to say together a prayer of confession as we reflect on what we have done or not done over this past week. Let us say together, Father, whose very name is love, we are like sheep who go astray. We have wandered from your paths of life and light. We have heard the shepherd's voice calling us by name, but we have turned instead to our own way. Show us your tender mercy. Restore us in the security of your fold. Lead us back to still waters. Seat us again at your bounteous table. Fill us with your spirit that we might bear glad witness to your saving mercy. Reveal to us in the great shepherd, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And still in this reflective mood, we're going to sing seated. O now, Father, mindful of the love that bought us on Calvary's tree. That's verses 1 and 2. And now, O Father, mindful of the love that bought us once for all on Calvary's tree, and have in with us Him that leads above. And so, brothers and sisters, having confessed our sins, be assured of the assurance of salvation, that this is the message we have heard from God and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in Him there is no darkness at all. If we walk in the light as God is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. So in the name of Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. And let the church of God, let the church say, Amen. Thanks be to God. And we continue to give thanks as we sing the song, Give Thanks as Forgiven Sons and Daughters of the High King.
And with that, I now will turn over.
Someone who is greater than I, whose foot straps I'm not even worthy to untie. And we're going to have Sister Carberry come to give us the welcome. Sister Carberry.
Thank you, Brother Professor Michael Boyne. Sisters and brothers, what a blessing it is to be able to worship God in freedom yet again, especially as we approach the celebration of emancipation and independence. We give God thanks for the freedom to worship Him. And on behalf of the other stewards on duty, Sister Karen Taylor and Brother Newton Amos, I bid you all a very warm welcome to our worship and fellowship this morning. Whether you're worshiping with us in the sanctuary or you're worshiping online, we welcome you heartily and trust that this service will be a blessing for all of us. Extend special welcome to our preacher, Brother Michael Boyne, accompanied by his dear wife, Sister Sandra Boyne, who is in the congregation. And welcome also to all the other facilitators of our worship this morning, the digital team, the musicians, the ushers, and the security personnel, all working together to make our worship of God rich and possible. Do we have any persons worshiping in the sanctuary for the first time? If so, will you please stand? No first-time worshipers. If there are any first-time worshipers online, please so indicate in the chat so we can recognize you as well. I now invite the praise team.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. That's better, thank you. As we continue this worship service this morning, let us stand as we sing. This morning, of course, we don't have our usual projection, so our songs this morning will be Alpha and Omega, followed by I Am Blessed, If You Know the Lord is Keeping You, and Shout to the Lord. So don't you worry, I'll remind you as we go along. But these are all songs that we are very familiar with. So let us stand if we're able and make a joyful noise together unto the Lord.
We give you all the glory. We give you all. we know that we are a blessed people. I am blessed. I am blessed. Every day of my life, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed. I am blessed. I am blessed.
I want to pray the wonders of
Amen.
Team for helping to continue the spirit of worship that we have this morning. And as we enter the ministry of the word, we will pray together the collect for today. So let us pray together. You can remain seated. Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask, and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness, and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not, and for our blindness we cannot ask. Through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We'll now have a series of readings. First, a responsive reading, Old Testament epistle, and the gospel, followed by the spoken word. I invite us to stand for the responsive reading, which is taken from Psalm 52, or if you're following in your VIP, number 598. Why do you boast, O mighty one, of mischief done against the godly? All day long you are plotting destruction. Your tongue is like a sharp razor, you worker of treachery. You love all the words that devour, O deceitful tongue. The righteous will see and fear and will laugh at the evildoer, saying, but I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. I trust in the steadfast love of God forever and ever. Is good. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated, and we'll have our first reading. We have a recurrence of Sister Sharda Small, who will be here to read. Thank you, Sharda.
Our first reading comes to us from Amos chapter 8, verses 1 through 12. This is what the Lord God showed me, a basket of summer fruit. He said, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a basket of summer fruit. Then the Lord said to me, the end has come upon my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The songs of the temple shall become wailings in that day, says the Lord God. The dead bodies shall be many, cast out in every place. Be silent. Hear this, you that trample on the needy and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so that I may sell grain, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah small and the shekel great and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals and selling the sweepings of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. Shall not the land tremble on their account, and everyone mourn who lives in it, and all of it rise like the Nile, and be tossed about and sink again like the Nile of Egypt? On that day, says the Lord God, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth in broad daylight. I will turn your feasts into mourning, and all your songs into lamentations. I will bring sackcloth on all loins,
and baldness on every head. I will make it like the morning for an only son, and the end of it like a bitter day. The time is surely coming, says the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread or a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea and from north to east. They shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. This is the word of the Lord.
Reading is taken from Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 28. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He's the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. And through him, God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. And you who were once estranged and hostile in mind, doing evil things, he has now reconciled in his fleshly body through death, so as to present you holy and blameless and irreproachable before him, provided that you continue securely established and steadfast in the faith, without shifting from the hope promised by the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven. I, Paul, became a servant of this gospel. I am now rejoicing in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am completing what is lacking in Christ's affliction for the sake of his body, that is, the church. I became its servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known. The mystery that has been hidden throughout the ages and generations, but has now been revealed to his saints. To them God chose to make known his great among the Gentiles. To them, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of his glory, of his mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. This is the reading of the epistle. Thanks be to God.
Gospel. And as is customary on Church Sunday, we'll read
Lord, answer us, say, Martha, Martha, you're bad about yourself about all the sin thing. But only one sin thing you bother yourself about. Mary make up her mind to pick that one thing, and nobody now go top her. Now as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks, so she came to him and asked, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you're worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken from her. This is the word of Christ.
Brothers and sisters, I usually use a text from the Old Testament, but when I read Amos 8 verse 10,
so I'll put a sackcloth around everyone's waist and baldness upon every head. I decided against using anything about baldness as someone who's also follicularly challenged. Right, Reverend Mulrain? So we're not going to speak about biblical meanings of baldness today. We're going to speak on something else. And I love Colossians 1, verse 15 to 28, which was read by Sister Barbara. And it speaks of the majesty of God and the supremacy of Jesus. And this is especially, as I mentioned in my prayers of adoration, that, you know, the new images of the universe, I don't know if you've seen them by the James Webb Telescope that have been on the media this week, which are truly awe-inspiring. But we have no multimedia this week. So I cannot show you any pictures, AKA, or maybe there should be more people joining the multimedia team so that we have it every week. Praise the Lord, yes. So I can't show you pictures. So maybe another sermon in the future. But Colossians 1, 23 and 25, Paul mentions, I became his servant, and I reflected how we should serve him. And this is, and there's one area that I've been mulling about for a long time, but even more so since June 24. And I'm going to tell it to you as a story. But it's also Family Sunday. And it's on a topic that affects us as families. And parents, just letting you know as a disclaimer, I've been speaking on a mature theme, but I won't be using any offensive language. So I apologize up front if it makes anybody feel a little uncomfortable. But before we start, as a family of God and as a lover of children, I did not forget the children. And I want us to have a blessing for the children where they are right now. So I don't know if there's any children. I'm looking around, not seeing to. If there's any children, they could just stand up where you are. Just stand up where you are. I think, oh, we have one upstairs. We have another big child upstairs. We have a couple downstairs. Just stand where you are. Don't come forward. We just want to have a blessing on you. And so I just ask the adults which are near to those children just to either reach out towards them or to touch them if you are in their immediate circle of family and friends. And let us just bless the children. So we pray, may that you understand how deep is God's love for you. May you always remember he sent his only son, Jesus, so that you might live and live the best life of all. May Jesus' love set the standard for the way you love others throughout your young lifetime. Never forget that God fills you with his love, so you in turn can give love to others. So let us all say together to these children now, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his face towards you and give you his peace. God bless the children. We can't forget the children. Amen. We're going to be continuing a little bit on in a sort of thinking a little bit, which involves children. And I'm going to start, as I mentioned, with just a story. And this story is actually over 30 years old. And to the children, yes, I am that old. And over 30 years ago, I used to lead a youth group meeting here at Providence. Now, I don't know if Phyllis is here, Phyllis Jones. Phyllis, Sister Phyllis, who had her birthday just recently. She actually started a group for teenagers because Sunday school in those days used to end somewhere around 13, 14. Because people should have been confirmed and moved into church. But a lot of children still didn't quite fit into church, didn't quite fit into Sunday school shows. Phyllis started that teen group and I took it over. And later it became a more youthful version of the Wesley Guild. So, but one Sunday night, more than 30 years ago, around 7 p.m., I got a call from one of the guys in the group. Uncle Michael, I really need to talk to you. I need your help. His tone and his words were urgent. So much so that I agreed to meet him. So I drove to his house, and because it sounded urgent, I prayed along the way for spiritual wisdom. I reached about 8 p.m. He greeted me outside and asked that we talk outside. His girlfriend, another Wesley Guild member who I knew well, was also there. And they had been dating for a while. And the two looked very serious and obviously worried. So we actually sat down on the sidewalk and their stories started to emerge. He did most of the talking. She had missed that time of month and her test was positive. They were literally beside themselves with confusion and grief. I held her hand and asked her what was she thinking. She said she wanted to do a procedure. She explained, I have to finish school. My mom doesn't know what is going on. You see, the same thing happened to our older sister, and that older sister had the baby. However, the damage that she saw to her family and the destruction of her sister's dreams and career aspirations were severe. She said, I can't put my mother and family through this again. Not to also mention the shame that she said that she felt. So the three of us, sitting on the sidewalk, discussed her options that Sunday evening, including getting more counseling, maybe to return to school in some capacity after having the baby, adoption, as well as a procedure. Since I was in medical school at the time, we also spoke about the implications of the procedure, what would happen, and how she might even feel afterwards. And after about an hour of talking, it was obvious that they didn't want to go to anyone else for counseling. It was me. It wasn't a minister. It wasn't for professional counselors, etc. So I was the only person they were going to talk to. And they were pretty resolute in their decision. So yes, my family here at Providence, I want to speak on an issue that affects us as individuals and as families. And sometimes as families, we need to talk about practical realities. I mentioned that I've been thinking more so since June 24, because some of you might be aware that that was a day an uproar emerged in the United States when their Supreme Court reversed Roe v. Wade, and removed reproductive rights as a federally protected constitutional right. And the uproar extended here to Jamaica, which I found it also a little bit ironic, as many people didn't remember that by Jamaican law, these procedures are illegal, with heavy penalties. Now, according to a study by Capri at the university, some 22,000 pregnancies are terminated in Jamaica every year. It is mostly impoverished women who flock to unprofessional and unsafe centers to have the procedures. And for those of you who are financially minded, Jamaica pays over $212 million annually for complications when it's done in these sort of unprofessional and unsafe centers. So, like the United States, the debate rages here about whether you should be pro-life or pro-choice. And I'm not going to ask you today which side you are on. This is not the setting for such a conversation. Neither am I going to preach or prescribe what is the right way. So whether you're pro-life or pro-choice, or even a hybrid of that, I want to speak to the family of God, because our mantra should be that we are pro-Jesus. Could I have an amen for that? Amen. We're pro-Jesus. And what I want to speak about is our response to women who are in a sticky situation. And one thing that I've always been impressed about Jesus is that everyone who was troubled, everyone who was afflicted, everyone who was sick or desperate had no compunction to go to him and unburden themselves. All felt welcome in his presence. They didn't feel like they were going to be beaten down or cursed or had to endure a sermon of what was wrong with them. They went to him because they felt his compassion. They felt his mercy. They felt his grace. They felt his love. He had words which were kind and uplifting. And he welcomed everyone, the poor, the Pharisee, the traitor, the leper, the prostitute, the Gentile, the outcast. He loved all, healed all, comforted all, but he challenged all to be better in their walk with God. Now, Jesus is the master physician, and people who were sick physically or mentally, spiritually or emotionally went to him. And the church should be likewise. You can come, be welcomed, be wheeled in to see the nurse or doctor, receive treatment, and be discharged back to your home. There's an old saying that the church is a hospital for the sinners. Have you heard that? And some add, it's a hospital for sinners and it's not a museum for saints. And St. John Chrysostom said, the church is a hospital and not a courtroom for souls. She does not condemn on behalf of sins, but grants the remission of sins. And I firmly believe this. And this concept may have come from Luke 5 when Jesus said, healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. I've come not to call the righteous, but those who know that they are sinners and need to repent. So, is our church home, Providence, like that? Do people feel welcome to come and receive care in a loving way? Is our motto, if you are down, come to us? And some of us right now, sitting or listening, may even be sick yourself. Do you feel you can come to the church to unburden yourself? Can you? Now, in this issue
of reproductive rights. What are we doing in our ministries? Just as to think, especially our ministry to women. And I speak to a body here where the demographic is mostly women. Do young women feel our presence and our care? Do we shy away from hot button issues with our young people? Do we speak openly about it? When I was growing up, and I grew up in this church, I can say that if I want to find information about human sexuality, I wouldn't come to the church. It was rarely, if ever, mentioned. What can we do better? What services can we offer? Now, we also need to remember that the church is not just Providence Methodist Church located at 132 Old Hope Road, Kingston 6. It is not a building. It's not Reverend Litchmore. The church is us. Every one of us. We are its hands, its feet, its eyes, every part of the body. We are the doctors and nurses in this hospital. So if we are pro-Jesus, which you said amen to, are we like our Lord and Master? Do others in our family, our community, feel comfortable to approach us as individuals now with their problems, whether minor or major, or even as in this case, sexual? Or do our words tell of a more harsh or legalistic attitude? Do they fear reprisal or judgment? So I'm really asking, do people feel at ease in our presence as individuals and feel willing to unburden themselves? When they see us, do they feel as if the Lord has said, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest"? Do they feel like Simon Peter, who said, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life"? Now, Bill Clinton in the 1990s said that he wanted to make abortion to be safe, legal, and rare. I kind of like that statement because 22,000 is a big number per year. But you see, it speaks to us working together to make an environment that if our sister is in trouble, she feels the support of us as individuals and as the family and community of God, working towards a solution and to give her options without condemnation. We should affirm human life is precious, but we don't walk in her shoes and we don't experience her life. Remember, there go I, but for the grace of God. We should be mindful of the love that saved us once for all on Calvary's tree. And I believe that a more strong pro-Jesus attitude, we can make things uncommon, maybe even rare. I read a commentary in the Gleaner, and I'm going to quote from these words. I want you to listen carefully. It said, "The fact," and this is said by a member of the clergy, "the fact that every individual was created in the image of God, which means that everyone has equal access to be transformed by the word of God, regardless of their shortfalls. I believe in the same way," the commentary goes on, "if I came into church and I were a prostitute or a drunkard, by coming into the church and through the word, there's a prospect of transformation. There's no barrier for me where I'm going to say, because you are homosexual or because you did an abortion, you should be targeted. You might not have committed an abortion, but lying, stealing, and killing are all sins. The woman was caught in adultery, but what was Jesus' response? If you have never sinned, but yet you threw a stone at her and everybody went away. So the church community ought to embrace each other regardless." You know who said that? Bishop Christine Benguche, our bishop. You might be wondering what happened to that teenager I told you in the story, a real story. We spoke for a long time. We prayed about the options. She was resolute in her decision. I organized for her to see a competent, compassionate gynecologist to talk with. And she went. I called her afterwards. She had decided to do the procedure. It was done safely, and she did well physically. Emotionally, she said that she was more at peace afterwards. However, I knew in my interactions that she did pay a price, spiritually and emotionally. All of our actions are not without consequences. But I told her I loved her the same as before, and I would support her emotionally and spiritually. She finished school, gained a career, started her own family. That was over 30 years ago. Some may say, Michael, you didn't do the right thing. My reply in issues like this, I rather err on the side of mercy. The story of Mary and Martha in the gospel is also insightful. Jesus was an honored guest in the home of Mary and Martha, and he had an entourage of at least 12 men. That's a lot of guests. If I bring home 13 men to my wife, unannounced, I don't need to say more. So obviously there's a lot of things to do practically to provide the hospitality of food and entertainment. And Martha was quite right to be consumed with getting everything in place. She was in the right place for a first century society where women were also second class citizens. And Mary was a rogue by not helping, and worse, as a woman, she was there sitting and fellowshipping with the men. Something that you don't do in those days. Mary, however, was praised by God, by the Lord, by God's sake, for seeking after a higher good. And in a similar way, let us always seek the higher good as we provide comfort, compassion, and love to others as we try to guide them along his path. To wrap up, in preparation for this service, I listened to the music and spoken word broadcast with the Mormon Tabernacle Choir and Orchestra. And that's something which touched me greatly, and I want to quote freely from what was said. So I quote, "A long time ago, noted preacher Dwight Moody told his congregation a story about a boat helplessly rocking and plunging on a stormy, starless night near Cleveland Harbor. The mariners on board could see the lighthouse, but they needed to find their way through the narrow passage in the treacherous rocks that surrounded the harbor. Normally, a light on the shore aligned with the lighthouse, marking the passage to safety. But on this night, the lower light had gone out. Finally, the desperate captain decided he had no choice but to proceed into the harbor without the guidance of the lower lights. And with a strong hand and a brave heart, but almost in total darkness, this old pilot turned the wheel. Tragically, he missed the channel, crashed the boat upon the rocks, and lost the lives of his sailors. Moody then explained the lesson to be learned from the story. The master will take care of the great lighthouse, but he depends on us to keep the lower lights burning. The storms of life put many of us in peril. They may long to approach the light of our Father's mercy, but they're not sure how to navigate the obstacles in their way. We all know how they feel because each of us has been lost at sea at some time, each one of us. Most often, God uses us to rescue them. If we can keep the light of faith burning in our hearts, if we align our light with the light above, we can guide an exhausted mariner home. We can be the lower lights that send a gleam across the wave. Some poor, fainting, struggling seaman we may rescue, we may save. Let us also rescue desperate women and desperate men and guide them home here at Providence and in our personal lives. So Philip Paul Bliss was so inspired by Moody's story that he wrote the popular hymn, "Brightly Beams Our Father's Mercy." Let us now sing it prayerfully as we think about the spoken word. Godfrey.
The wind brightly beams our Father's mercy from His love.
Doctors and nurses in your hospital, the church. May your compassion and love burn bright within us. May we be a lower light attracting your people to us and point them towards you. Your people may have an unwanted pregnancy, a health issue, a distressing situation, Some of us here may be in that situation. May they see God in us, offering help in their time of need. We ask for your Spirit, even now, to hover over them and us, just as you hovered over the waters in the moment of creation. Show us how to practically teach your way in sensitive issues, how to design outreach and to manage ministries that bring your kingdom a step closer here on earth, that we may rescue some poor, fainting, struggling seamen. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Church is a hospital for sinners and not a museum for saints. Is Providence a welcoming community for sin-sick souls? Challenging questions from our brother for our reflection and contemplation. Thank you, brother, for that challenge. We come now to the notices and offerings for today. There'll be two offerings today, the regular offering and the offering for the care fund. Since we have no multimedia projection, I will have to read the more important notices. But we begin with our birthday and anniversary celebrants. Sister Joan Leiber on the 17th, Sister Sharda Small on the 18th, Sister Isaline Livingston on the 21st, Sister Patricia McDowell and Sister Avis Morris on the 22nd, and Sister Barbara Pete on the 23rd. Will those persons stand, please, if they are present, so that we can sing happy birthday to them? Happy birthday, happy birthday. Do we have any wedding anniversary celebrants present with us today? No? I then go on to the other notices. The Mission and Evangelism Committee will meet on Monday coming, the 18th, and the Resources and Development Committee will meet on Thursday, July 28th. Please note those special notices, and the regular weekly meetings of the other groups continue, the choirs and the Bible study and prayer fellowship groups. We express condolences to Mr. Eric Dinham, one of our security officers, and his family on the death of his son, Mr. Mario Dinham. Thanksgiving services for Sister Mavis Crosdale, the mother of Reverend Charlene Burton, will be held at Constitution Hill Methodist Church on Saturday, July 23 at 1 p.m. Also for Mr. Layton Shirley, brother of Sister Dawn Muir and Sister Valerie Crawford, will be held Friday, July 29 at 10 a.m. here at Providence. for Mr. James Rose, brother of Sister Dorrit Solomon, Sister Icy McKen, and Sister Pearl Chung, will be held on Saturday, July 30 at the Portmore Methodist Church. And for Miss Barbara Campbell, sister of Sister Jacqueline Senior, will be held Thursday, August 4, here at Providence at 10 a.m. One of our church secretaries, Sister Rhea Thomas, is on leave from July 15 to August 1. And our district will be having virtual summer camps this year. So you can get in touch with the district office to find out the arrangements for virtual summer camps, not in-person camps as was previously announced. And I'm happy to announce that the benefit performance for Brother Devon Brewster, that the tickets, Sister Shardo informed me earlier that the tickets for the performance have been sold out. So we give God thanks for that. The National Dance Theatre Company performance on July 23 at 8 p.m. Tickets are now sold out. You can still get Methodist Pure Honey from the district office. And may I put in a reminder that I still have copies of the Jamaica New Testament for sale to those persons who haven't yet acquired them. You can give it to yourself or somebody else as an emancipation present this year and rise to the challenge of learning the orthography, how to spell it. Not hard, it's simpler than English. You can take my word for that. It took me many years to learn English, and it took me a few hours to learn how to write the Jamaican New Testament. So you can follow my example. Giving for the work of our church continues in several formats. You can go online, and you can also drop off your collection at the office during the week or when you come to worship on a Sunday. I think that brings to an end the immediate notices. Reverend Mulrain would like to speak to us on a matter or two.
Thank you, Sister Shirley. Brothers and sisters, good morning. I want to speak as a member of HACO. Now, HACO is Hope Area Churches organization. HACO consists of some 10 churches or congregations within the Hope area, and you would, for example, know it if we were doing a little tour. We would begin at Peter and Paul, Saints Peter and Paul, and we come up here to Providence, and then just a couple of doors from us is the Hope, the Mona Gospel Assembly Church. And then we have St. Margaret's. And following St. Margaret's, we'd come to Mona Open Bible Church. That's near to KFC. And then there is Hope United Church, the Church of the Ascension. The Christian Life Assembly is on Gordontown Road, Mona Baptist, and then there is, of course, St. Thomas Aquinas. Did I mention St. Margaret's? Okay, I just want to make sure, because I know we have some persons in this congregation who are related to St. Margaret's. I don't want to be lynched. So there are 10 churches which comprise HACO, but the purpose of talking about HACO is to say that we have had what we call a Values and Attitudes Train the Trainers course, a Value and Attitudes Train the Trainers course, a 10-week training course which was done online, and there are two of us Providence persons who participated in that Train the Trainers course, Values and Attitudes. Dr. Eileen Standard Golson. Is Dr. Golson in congregation this morning? But anyway, I was looking to where she normally sits, but she's not here with us this morning, but Sister Golson and I, we attended this course, and of course, Values and Attitudes emphasize some of the things that we need in Jamaica, you know, respect for crime and violence. So we had in this course emphases on respect, self-discipline, social responsibility, honesty, family, and so on. And this course was masterminded by Mr. Reginald Boudin. He's a national coordinator of it. And we had 3 weeks ago, June the 26th, there was this certification. And Sister Eileen Golson and I, because we had attended the course and we had successfully completed it, we were awarded a certificate. It was a ceremony which took place at Peter and Paul, and Minister of Education and Youth, Favell Williams, was present. And we are therefore now two of the, what we call the ambassadors, HACO ambassadors now, for Values and Attitudes. So I just wanted to share this with you to let you know that at some time within the next few weeks or so, Sister Golson and I will be rallying our thoughts together to see how best we can encourage Providence to be on board with this Values and Attitudes course that has been spearheaded under the auspices of HACO. Thank you very much, Sister Shirley, and thank you, Brother Michael.
Oh, well, it won't come off, but I think you will hear me clearly. I am the second part of the first part. And this is something from the UTCWI, which I'm sorry to say I haven't seen it advertised in this congregation. There's a course being run at the UTCWI beginning on Saturday, the 23rd of July, running through to September 3, 7 Saturdays, 9 a.m. to noon. The title is Music and Worship. It covers technological fundamentals of church audio, the value of the digital world to church maintenance and growth, the value of music in the functional life of the church, how to identify defining features of Caribbean church music, how music enhances church life. It is for choir directors, pastors, deacons, musicians, retreat leaders, lay leaders, choir members, praise team members, and regular church members, anybody who is interested in music and worship. It so happens that the presenter of the course is one Godfrey Taylor, and you are invited to contact the UTCWI if you wish to register. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Godfrey. Our offering for the work of God will now be received. As I said before, there are two offerings today, regular offering and the offering for the care fund, and the baskets are in their usual places and duly labeled. So I invite you after the prayer to come up and deposit your offerings. Let us pray. Bountiful God, your goodness never fails. You daily shower us with blessings too numerous to recall, and we are thankful. And as you have commanded us as stewards of your creation, we now seek to share of your bounty with those who are less fortunate. So we pray that you will inspire us to give generously so that we may help to meet the needs of those who have too little. And we pray that you will bless and multiply our offerings, and that you will guide those who have charge of them to distribute them as you would have them distributed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Have made them to be lower lights shining for others. We ask that you let them feel confident and ready for the year ahead, knowing that you have a purpose for their life and you have ordered their steps. Help them to find joy in every circumstances, and that you will work out all things for good. We thank you that you speak over their life, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Have a blessed day. But today already comes. But sisters. But we all know that they're only about 19 years old. Isn't that right?
Yes. None of them are day over 19. So, amen. Brothers and sisters, we're going to have a period of intercession. And so I invite us that we remain seated for this as we have our prayers. Because we do need to pray for our people, Jamaica. We need to pray for our church. We know that right now we are stricken with poverty and COVID and crime and violence, indiscipline, domestic abuse, child abuse, and corruption. So let us bind our hearts together as we approach our Lord. Let us pray. Father, we remember even now our government as they struggle with the problems that were just listed. Remember our Prime Minister, the Cabinet, the Parliament, the Senate, the local government, the judiciary. We ask that everyone represented there, their hearts and minds be filled with your Spirit. Because we know your Spirit brings peace, wisdom, and love. So that they can make the right decisions to help us and establish economic stability, law and order, and relief in this pandemic. Father, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we know that there's so much violence and corruption, and we pray for an end to it at all levels in our society. There's violence and corruption in our families, communities, the boardroom. Families are torn apart by domestic abuse, man versus woman, parent versus child, elder versus younger, and sexual and emotional abuse suffered by so many. And our hearts cry out for people trapped, especially children, in these circumstances. We need a word from you, so help us to reach out in practical ways, especially to our young people. Father, in your mercy. We want to pray for our children as they are hopefully enjoying the summer. We know that some of them are a bit anxious because they're also waiting for exam results. But we pray that their hearts are filled with joy, especially as their lives have been disrupted, their education has been disrupted by COVID. But we pray that they all reach their God-given potential. And we ask that you provide for them materially and that you help them to realize that all good gifts come from you, our Lord and Savior of all. So, Father, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember our connectional Bishop George, our Jamaica Bishop Christine, our Presbyter Barrington. We remember all stewards, Sunday school teachers, preachers, class leaders, musicians, tech teams, admin teams, and everyone who's a part of this family of God. We ask that you bind us together with cords of love and that we function as a real community of light, wisely using your patience, power, and wisdom. Father, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the outcast, the stranger, the immigrant, victims of crime, the prisoner, the addicted, the bereaved, the hopeless, victims of trafficking. We pray for those who are in hospital, in nursing homes, those who are desperate, suicidal, oppressed. May we be a hospital and a source of comfort to all. Touch their bodies with healing, their minds with peace and joy, and their hearts with the witness of your Spirit. And we remember especially, even now, those amongst us who are ill. We remember Brother Milton Arthurs, Laurel Bruce, Helen Chambers, Keturah Forrest, Pearl Morgan, Gertrude Phillips, Violet Tapper, Cynthia Walsh, Clover Treasure, Bernice Saunders, Lena Anderson, Herbert Bartholomew, Grace Boyne, Joyce Bolton, Alma Smith, Verna George, Iseline Livingston, Lester Palmer, Gwendolyn Thomas, Pam Morris, Mira Lewis, Pauline Mason, Marjorie Smith, Sadie Mitchell, Carmen Subaron, May Polak, Janice Robinson, Inez Bernard, Eric King, Rupert Young, Roy Thomas, Carmen Alacock, Mina McLeod, Hazel Bennett, Ivy Holder, Trevor Weston, Dorman Buchanan, Flo Armstrong, Verona Cameron. And we also remember those who have been amongst us who have been bereaved. And we pray that your Spirit will touch their hearts where they need touch or healing. Touch their bodies where they need healing. Touch their spirits where they also need healing. So, Father, in your mercy, hear prayer. And in this hurricane season, we pray for your protection, individually as well as for our properties. We remember that earthquakes and other natural disasters could also occur. So again, we ask for your protection and wisdom to be better stewards of your earth. Father, in your mercy. And finally, Lord, make us all united in love, that special love that can only come from above, and spur us onwards to use our gifts to help build the body of Christ. For these and more, we ask in Jesus' holy and precious name. And let the people of God say, amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, as we are coming to the formal end of this service, but we know our service continues outside of these walls, I pray that you continue to walk with God throughout this week. So we rise and sing, just a closer walk with thee. participate in today's service. You know yourselves, but I want to say thank you. And I thank you, everyone who also tuned in, whether online or came physically here. It is a blessing to be among the family of God. Please receive now the benediction. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who has loved us and give us eternal comfort and good hope by grace, comfort and strengthen your hearts in every good work and word. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Thank you.
For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything, oh Lord. Your goodness is running.
Oh,
you're going, in your weeping and rejoicing, He's for you, He's for you.
For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness